Okay, hello everyone. Now we can start. So if you have any question regarding networks and communication, especially from the previous week, we talked about the internet. No problem. So if you have any question, you can ask any random question about networks or communications. So no question, then we can start. So basically in the previous lecture we discussed about the internet, right? We are using the internet, so in terms of its applications, we know that we have Facebook, like all the websites that are using, obviously the internet is behind it, okay? WhatsApp, Skype, Zoom calls. So the internet is a federated system. So who will tell what is a federated system? Because you don't have any question, it means that last lecture is clear to you. So who will tell what is a federated system in networks? Anyone? Yeah.
Because all devices are linked to each other.
Yeah.
Also in a competitive system.
Yeah, good, good. So basically we have so many devices and they should be compatible with each other, right? We cannot enforce someone to use some particular sort of devices, right? Like I cannot ask some people to, okay, you can only use this hardware or software even. I cannot restrict, okay, only Windows users can use this sort of thing, okay? So this is federated system. We have diverse system. This internet is diverse, having so many different platforms, different devices, different operating systems, softwares, but we want to communicate with each other. We want communication sort of thing, okay? And that's why we also discussed one important aspect of federated system is interoperability. Interoperability is that if one thing is running on some particular platform, it should run on some other platform as well. Okay, so this sort of interoperability, like we are not restricting because of some diversity in hardware or software. So imagine that's why if you go any part of the world and you can easily use the internet. Imagine if you go some other country, let's say Australia, and you have to reinstall all your Windows or Mac operating system and reinstall some other operating systems. Even you have to change your hardware sort of thing, network cards, then obviously it would be very, very difficult for a common people to use this internet, okay? So that's why it's a federated system, but we do require interoperability in terms of hardware, in terms of software, in terms of applications, in short, because the end user is more concerned about the application, okay? You are more concerned, or normal people or simple people who are not IT concerned or business related, they have only concern with the graphical user interface of your application. They don't want to know how WhatsApp is encrypting your messages or how they are able to sending your messages from one part of the world to the other part of the world, okay? So the internet is a federated system, and obviously scale is quite huge. We talked about this thing. We have around 20 billion devices which are using internet, right? And obviously with the passage of time in 5 years, these number of devices might be doubled, right? So scalability is another issue. And with tremendous dynamic range and diversity, that is asynchronous in operation. So what is asynchronous? Who will tell? Asynchronous operation or asynchronous communication. Opposite is obviously synchronous communication, in which we have to wait for someone else to complete its job, right? But in the internet, we have to make applications which should be asynchronous. like, okay, I have to send some request to someone, but it will not, I don't have to wait and or stop something, okay? I can do something else. So this sort of communication or operation is asynchronous, okay? Where you are not halted, where you are not stuck just for waiting someone's action to complete, okay? So this is asynchronous in operation. And we also discuss about this thing, failure prone, okay? So even if you have 99% up success rate of any device, still there is a chance of 35% of failure, because if you are sending some data from NUIG to some other university at US or some other place in US, right? So thousands of devices and links would be in between that thing. And even if a single device failed or overburdened due to some data, we will see how data or packets are lost during the communication, okay? So this communication failure can happen. So why we are discussing this thing, and obviously constantly evolving, because as a business people, if you have to make some application or design some application based on the internet, you must know that what are the bottlenecks of the internet, right? What are the main points or consideration that you should consider before going to adopt some application or develop some application? You should know that what are the dynamics of the internet, okay? So these are the few important characteristics of the internet that you must consider if you are making some application regarding the internet, which would be using the internet. Right now or nowadays, you know that every business is, even most of the businesses, like you know that Uber, right? All of you know that Uber, it's not in Ireland, right? Uber is not here. But it's some sort of online taxis where you can hire cars or you can go, right? But you know that Uber has no car. Physically, Airbnb sort of thing, right? They don't have their own hotels or restaurants or some sort of things, but they are just, via the internet, they are connecting different landlords, people who want to share their rooms or their cars, and they just connecting the people with the person who need it, okay? And this is all because of the internet. Without internet, there are so many businesses. Obviously, they wouldn't exist. Amazon is one example. Google is another example. Facebook is another example. So you can imagine right now, even all the physical sort of things, even they do require internet, even if they don't have to communicate with the customers. For example, can you think without the internet, banks can work? Banks, right? They have their own dedicated intranet, but obviously they are using the same internet infrastructure. They are not using some special lines or something. They are only more skewed part of the internet, okay? So they are using internet behind your transactions. Every ATM is connected because of this internet or networks sort of thing. So you can imagine, right? We cannot imagine any business nowadays without the internet. Then we talked about this thing. So 8th edition is not yet available, but it's fine if you can go with 7th edition, or global edition is also there. But all the slides would be available. So as such, there is no need to purchase this book. Okay. Might be in the library. You can also get some copy of 7th edition or global edition. So in this course, no need to buy or purchase this book, but it's good if you can purchase it, and if you want to read chapters, then definitely it would be a good practice for you. The internet, and then we discuss about this thing that billions of connected devices, computing devices, we call this sort of thing is edge, just like a cloud. At the cloud, outside the cloud, there is an edge, and these computing devices are known as network edge. Then we have packet switches. So what is a packet? Who will tell?
The
Sorry?
8 bits of dial-up transfer.
Yeah, yeah. So basically, in computer networks or in simply networks, what we do is we divide our data. For example, you are sending one PDF file to someone or emailing by using Gmail or something, right? Then this data would be divided into small packets, okay? And then these packets would be transferred independently, and then it will be staged at the destination, and it will present as a one data to the application at the destination host, okay? So it can transfer in different ways. It might happen some of your data is going through Canada and some of your data is going through directly to US, so through some optical fiber or something. And then at the host computer, it will stitch again and present it as a one image that you are sending to someone, okay? So packets are just small parts of your data that you are going to send. That data could be images, that data could be your username, password thing. It could be anything that you are using on the or sending through the internet, okay? So packet switches, the important aspect of these packet switches are routers, okay? And these are the, this is the symbol for router, this is the symbol for switches. And switches are usually used in the local area settings. But if you want some data outside your network, then you must have some sort of router thing, okay? And we also saw, you can see this is a Wi-Fi router. Don't confuse with this Wi-Fi router with this router, okay? This is something different. This is just like more related to this switch sort of thing, but just we can say it Wi-Fi router, okay? And even this Wi-Fi router would be connected to some switch, okay? And you can see there is one cable. Even there is another one. So yeah, you can see from the Wi-Fi router, like you can connect with this Wi-Fi router, and this is the cable. Physical link is still needed, okay? So this Wi-Fi router is connected with some Ethernet, and this Ethernet or switch should be, let me check. Okay, so yeah, it's here. Some of them I cannot see, but so you can see this device is a switch, and one of the cable, physical cable, is going there, okay? So this cable is connecting to something here. It should be written PC5C21, okay? It would be someone. Okay, right? So physical link is important. So that's why this switch is here, and it's making, so this router, Wi-Fi router or Wi-Fi device, is connecting or making one network, okay? Like this, you can connect to this device, your laptop, to this device, and then obviously this device would be hardwired to some switch, just like this. And this hardwired switch would be ultimately linked with the NUIG router. And router is responsible for outside communication, okay? And router knows how and where to send data. If the server is in US or if the server is in the Australia, router has to decide. Router knows that this particular server, and how it will know on the basis of IP address. Okay? On the basis of IP address, router will know, okay, this IP address, for this IP address, I have to send data to this interface, which would be going to the Australia or something else. Okay? So router is very important for communicate for outside world communication. But if you don't want this thing to communicate outside your world, then obviously you can simply install some switches, some sort of this thing, or and then you can communicate within a one network, but obviously you cannot communicate outside. Okay. Any question? Now it's clear how internet works? Little bit. This course, whole course is about this thing, so don't worry if it's still not clear how your data, when you are writing some request or putting some URL, facebook.com on web page, how it's working behind it, right? So we will know it. So we require some softwares, we require some hardwares. So this laptop communication is connected with this Wi-Fi, NUIG Wi-Fi. This Wi-Fi is connected with Ethernet, which is connecting to the network of NUIG, right? Switch. And then this switch is communicating with the outside world through this router. Okay, and it could be like, because NUIG is quite big, so it depends how many routers they would have, but still as a router, functionalities would be same. Okay. So packet switches, then we have communication links. You know that we have fiber optics or copper wires, radio signals, satellite signals, right? And collection of devices, routers, links managed by an organization is networks. So we can see, so this is basically, you can say that this is NUIG network, which is connecting different devices, and then there are some sort of routers, internal routers, and then one router is communicating with the service, internet service provider. Okay, so it's for internet service providers, NUIG or GMIT or all the houses that are taking internet services from them, it's just a one network for them. Right? So NUIG is one network, or you can say that for this device, all the computers that are connected to it, making us one small network. Then when we are connecting to the switch or Ethernet sort of thing, then much bigger network, and then router is making another big network. So some sort of, you can say that supersets, okay? Subsets and supersets. And for ISPs, all the users are just like one computer for them, okay? Because they don't have to see how many computers people are using in the houses or at NUIG. The only concern for ISP is this link, providing services to this link, okay? And rest of the thing is obviously would be managed by internal routers or switches or Wi-Fi routers, okay? And we have regional ISPs, same is the case, then we would have some sort of national ISPs, right? And for national ISPs, that local ISPs would be simple one computer. So, you know, we are expanding the internet. So your regional ISPs would be connected with national ISPs, and then national ISPs would be connected with global ISPs. That's why we can communicate. US person who is sitting in US would be communicating with his or her local ISP. That local ISP would be communicating with US level ISP, and US level ISP and Ireland level ISP would be communicating with each other, would be transferring data over the internet. That's why they can easily find different persons or computers. They can transfer data, okay? Then we talked about different devices. There are so many devices nowadays because of there is a very emerging field, Internet of Things, edge computing is there, and like smart cities concept is there. So there is a lot of potential, still a lot of potential in terms of internet applications. If 50% or 55% of the population is using the internet, it means for you business scenarios in what do you call business opportunity? No, what is the exact term for business opportunity? Business gap, no? Business. If you have some, if your business has some potential to grow, what is the technical term to say it? I'm not a business field. I have no link with business fields. I'm from computer science background. I'm just
potential
learning.
Of scale.
Sorry?
The potential of scale.
Yeah. So, like, if you have to pitch your idea for business, what do you say it? What do you call?
Startup.
Sorry?
Startup.
Startup? Yeah, startup for startup, but there is some one terminology. Okay. Anyway, I will. Okay. So we have opportunities because only 54% of the people of the world are using internet, right? It means that we can make so many applications, or we can make it possible for other 45% of the population that are not using at all internet applications. And similarly, obviously, even people who are using the internet, we can expand services, we can expand applications, we can make new sort of applications so that people can they can use. So these are the different devices. So we talked about this thing that we have interconnected ISPs and they have different protocols are running on it, and by using different protocols and different terminologies or standards, we can use it, okay? So there is a one organization that would be controlling the standards. So we talked about this thing that network edge is simply your host, clients and servers. Access networks is a physical media. And then we have network core, which is interconnected routers. So basically, network core is a backbone of the internet. Without routers, we cannot communicate or send our data to the other networks, okay? So that's why this, from here you can communicate to this person who is using this laptop or even this one, right? So you have to select one path. From this path, you can go here, your data can go here or there, right? And obviously, you would be using different protocols, okay? HTTP is a protocol for communication. Any other protocol do you know by any chance, by typing something, or you know that this protocol is there at application level, I'm saying? Do you know FTP, file transfer protocol? No? Okay. FTP is there. Okay, HTTP, hypertext transfer protocol. All the websites, www, that you surf on the web browser uses HTTP. Okay, HTTPS is there, but it's just a secure version of HTTP, but the logic is same. So we have different layers. In today's lecture, we will talk about in more detail about layering. Okay, how many of you have fly somewhere by using aeroplanes? Many? Obviously, right? Or at least know that how flights or airlines work, right? So we will have one example shortly in which we see how these airlines, their working have been divided into different layers, and people who are working in one layer would be responsible for one thing, right? And at the destination airport, same sort of layer is working the same thing, okay? And in the networks case, same is the case with the networks. When you have to send your data, we would be dividing our data into different layers. Each layer has different work to do. And at the destination level, same layer level would be doing the same work that it should do, right? So access networks, cable-based access. So this is a simple diagram from, like, if this is my house or something, right? Obviously, it would be, some other houses would be connected with the same fiber optics, optical fiber, right? And then this would be connected to the ISP. So this is a simple general case. So in-house, obviously, usually nowadays, all of us would be connecting through a Wi-Fi, this sort of router, right, at home. And you can connect different devices. But generally, this router also contains this sort of router, right? So we can say that we are combining these three devices into a one device, something like this, for three different functionalities. So at a time, your house or your home router is making some sort of Ethernet sort of thing, because local switch, you can connect it just like this one, right? And it's also communicating with your ISP, just like some other routers. So we can merge functionalities of different devices into a one device. It's not difficult. So yeah, router, firewall, net, address translation basically. And then wired Ethernet, and we have different points, and often we can combine in a single box. So at NUIG, we discussed this thing that we would have some institutional mail web servers, we would have some Ethernet switches. This is the Ethernet switch, okay? Inside the cupboard, Ethernet switch, and this Ethernet switch is connected with the Wi-Fi router, that white one, Cisco Wi-Fi router, and where you can connect through your laptop, or even this machine would be connected with this in Ethernet directly with the cable. Okay, there would be some cable that would be going there. And then this complete network would be connected to one router, and then this router would be connected to some ISP. Okay, this switch, can anyone tell what is the functionality of this switch? Router, the functionality of the router, or you can say the external router, is clear, right? Or no? The functionality of a router. Who will tell? What is the functionality of the router? No. Yeah. So basically, if we want to communicate with some other networks, we need a router. Okay. If we want to communicate outside the world for a network, all the computers that are outside the network is outside world for us. So if we want to communicate with the outside world, or if we want to use the internet, then this router is compulsory, is mandatory, okay? You have to install it, you have to configure it. But then if we have a router, then can anyone guess what is the functionality of a switch? Why do we need this thing?
Collect all the devices in the router.
Yeah. One functionality could be this. It is collecting data from all the connected devices and sending it to the router. And the other thing, you're 100% correct, but it will also decide, should I send this data to the router or no? Might be this computer wants to communicate with this computer. So then there is no need of this router. So this switch will say, okay, data will come here and it will send to this and to this, okay? So for internal communication, local area communication, we also call it as intranet sort of thing, right? So for intranet, you don't need routers, switches, or these Ethernet switches will do this thing, okay? So if you want to send, this computer want to send data to this one, then it will be handled by these two devices. We don't need router. Router is only needed if your communication is outside your network. Okay. So host sends packet of data, host sending function. If I am sending a computer, if this computer is sending data to some other computer, obviously this is a host sending computer, okay. So host sending function is to takes application message, right? The interface of the WhatsApp is application, okay. So it will take data from the application, breaks into smaller chunks known as packets of length L bits, okay. Because why L bits? Because there would be some limit in every protocol, what would be the size of the packet, 10 bits, 20 bits, 50 bits, 60 bits. So you have to divide your data into that particular length that is defined by the protocol, okay. So known as packets of length L bits, but remember that if we are dividing our data into smaller chunks, do we need some other information as well so that at the destination we can use that information to stitch that data? Do we need that information? Like if I am dividing my data into 10 packets, I need to save something, some other information that this is packet 1, this is packet 2, so that I can stitch it correctly, right or no? Right? Because remember, your packets, it could be possible your packet number 1 would reach the destination late as compared to the packet number 10. It could be happen, right? It depends on the traffic or congestion or the path they are selecting. It could happen. But what do you think? If you are, if you don't have any information about stitching packet numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in sequence orders, can you make a correct picture that was actually sent? Obviously no, right? So it means that when you are sending or when you are dividing your data, you are you have to also send some extra information, how to stitch it or what is the packet number, right? So it means that if I have a capacity of 100 bits per packet, my data wouldn't be of size 100 bits. It would be 90 bits, and 10 bits would be information about that 90 bits. Okay? So we will see this thing. So transmits packet into access network at transmission rate R. So when we are dividing our packets into different length of L bits and we have transmission rate, right? Just like on motorways, we have transmission rate of, what is the speed, maximum speed at motorway? 120 kilometers per hour, right? So this is a basically transmission rate for any link. For physical link, if I'm talking about some road or motorway, it's 120 kilometer per hour, okay? So same is the case with the cable or with some other link, that it would have some transmission rate. And obviously you cannot send your data more than transmission rate, okay? On motorway might be you can go to 130, but during over the internet, you, if its capacity is 120, you cannot send data more than 120. But that 120 is still ideal, okay? So it's a bandwidth, okay, transmission. So usually your home ISPs, they say that your connection is, let's say, 1000 gigabit speed, right? They use very fancy speed terminologies. They only mentioning that their link has the capacity of sending data of this speed. That's why you cannot get 100 gigabits at your home, right? So it's different story. It's a, just a marketing story. So they have capacity, but there is no guarantee that you could send your data at that speed, okay? At your home or something. because in the previous pictures we saw that there is one common link that all of the houses are using. So even if motorway claim you can speed 120 km on the motorway, but there is a huge queue or large queue, right? You cannot drive your car at 120 km per hour speed, okay? So that's why you cannot get fast speed on local ISPs or something, because they claim speed according to their capacity, not the actual transmission rate, only the capacity. On the capacity of that, if 20 people or 50 people are there, there would be delay. And because of delay, then obviously you cannot get that speed, okay? So this is link transmission rate, and you can calculate what would be the packet transmission delay. Simply you can divide L with R, and you can see how much delay is there. Then physical media, we talked about this thing. We have different cables, twisted pairs, right? Coaxial cable, fiber optic cable. In many countries, like in Netherlands, I know they have like 35% or more than 35%. Even South Korea is very ahead of this, using optical fiber technology at homes. So almost 50% of their homes are now using optical fibers. So then we have wireless radio. Okay. And they have different capacity, obviously no physical wire, but they do require some sort of antennas, right, or towers. We have radio links, 3G, your 4G cellular or 5G sort of thing. These are the radio link types, okay. Bluetooth is also example of radio link types, but obviously you know that it has a very hardly 20 feet capacity or range, right? So any question? About networks, the internet? So the network core is a mesh of interconnected routers. We talked about this thing that local ISPs are connected to the national or global ISPs, okay? And packet switching is that host break application layer messages into packets. This is very important, packet switching, okay? And we will see there is another thing known as circuit switching, and why circuit switching is not good option for the internet. So we have two options, packet switching and circuit switching. Your landline phones use circuit switching sort of thing, where you have one dedicated line going from Galway to Limerick, so that people can talk, okay? But if that line is busy, I don't know how many of you have used landlines, because landline numbers, but you know that if you're calling someone on the landline, sometimes it would be busy. That number is not busy, the line would be busy. Just like when you would be dialing the area code of some city, it will be that like this line is busy, okay? Because the all the lines that are running from Galway to Limerick are busy. Your user is not busy, okay? So this is circuit switching. And obviously, for this sort of thing, we cannot use this thing in the internet. Remember, like if you want to, like, imagine you are sitting in NUIG and you want to connect with Facebook, and then there is one message pop up on your browser that 500 people are waiting, so just wait, you are in the waiting list, so your number is 501. So obviously no one would be using the internet if we would be using the circuit switching, same methodology that our landline phones are using, okay? So that's why we use packet switching. So two key network core functions in packet switching is like forwarding and routing sort of thing. So this is forwarding. So every router, so how this router will know that data coming from here will go to this place or this place? Any guess? For example, this the destination is this one. Okay? Data is coming from here to this router. You can say that this is NUIG router, okay, and it's connected with some other routers, or it's NUIG ISP, some sort of thing. How? Because the data can go from here, here to here, and might be from here as well, or even from here to here, okay. And just imagine there is no link, this one, this is broken. So how this router will decide which interface 1, 2, 3 would be selected to send data which is coming from here to, let's say, something here? Any guess how it will decide?
Yeah, so you see it has the destination address,
mm-hmm.
and above you see there's an algorithm like saying where that address needs to go to, and the 111,
yeah.
0111 matches with link 2.
Yeah.
So it must be going to link 2.
Yeah. So basically, good, every router has some sort of database. They know, and this sort of databases they share with each other. Okay? They share with each other that from this IP address to this IP address, I am available to send this data. Whenever you have some request for data for this sort of range, I can send it. Okay? And they periodically, with the passage of time, they share information with each other. Because there is possible, like this link is broken, then this router will tell other routers, don't send data for this link because it's not working, right? So this is known as forwarding, and it is done by some sort of routing algorithms. We will have a one lecture on this thing later on, but in week 7 or something. But in short, routers has two functionalities for forwarding and routing. Okay, and for forwarding and routing, they use one very very small database, small table, in which they know that this interfaces for this interface, for this link, I can send which IPs I can send. Okay, and even another information about this thing is that this router will tell to this router that what would be the cost, okay? What would be the cost if you want to use this link? And then this router will decide, okay, this is much cheaper than this one. Then it will send data to this link, okay? Just remember, ISPs have to pay according to the data size. Right now at home, you know that we don't have any restriction of such sort of thing, like unlimited data downloads. But you know that on mobile phone companies, they do charge according to your 1GB package or according to your 2GB package, right? This is data size that you want to use, because that ISPs have to pay these links or these people according to the size of the data that they have sent during 1 month or whatever, right? So they have to decide cheapest links that can provide. And obviously that cheapest links couldn't be possibly insecure. They are not reliable. So bottleneck is there, threshold is there. You have to decide, right? If you want to spend more money, or you want more reliability of your services. If you want more reliability, obviously, then this service would be more expensive. Okay, this is forwarding, and then routing. So forwarding is a local action. Move arriving packets from router's input link to appropriate router output link. So this forwarding is done by this small table. So if one packet is coming to this link, when I'm saying link, any idea what is that sort of thing? What is a link on a device, on a router? So just like your network card, you know that network card on your laptop? What is a network card on your laptop? Because without a network card, you cannot communicate. Okay, but most of you, because you are using Wi-Fi sort of thing, wireless sort of thing, that wireless card is a network card, okay, which is the part of your computer. But there are some computers which would have some network card interface. No? Do you have any computer in which we can plug network card? No? Oh, that table. No, I do. Most of the laptops does not require okay, where we can put cable in it. Okay, so basically when I'm talking about link, technically it's about network cards. Router has many network cards. Okay, they have different links. That's why they have one network card is connecting to this link, one network card is connecting to this one, second and third, right? And then this router will decide, okay, I have to send this data to any link, okay? So this is routing algorithm, forwarding. And then what is routing? This is a global action, and it determines source destination paths taken by packets. So routing algorithms will decide what would be the path, because when you are going to start communication, you have to select a path. Your network card would firstly make a path, virtual path. Okay, I will send this data through this thing. Okay, so this is routing. So just like this picture, if I have to move from this city to this city, then from city, within a city, I have to take some exits. I have to take some road which would be going to this thing, right? So this sort of thing is forwarding, right? And this sort of thing is routing, okay? I can go by this route or through this path. But obviously before that, I have to decide if I want to exit from the city, which road I would be taking, okay? Same is the case when I would be there, then again I would be. So this sort of thing is forwarding, and we saw routing thing. Okay, we can stop here. If you have any question, you can ask. So the picture, big picture of the internet should be clear to you. As a business student, it should be clear. What are the bottlenecks? What are the thresholds? And because all the applications would be based on your internet thing, right? So if you don't know how internet will work or how the internet would behave about particular application, obviously then this application would be a failure. No one would be using, because internet cannot support that thing. So 10 minute break. Okay, we can start now. I hope all are here. So far we have discussed what is internet, like we talked about network core, network edges, right? And in the next lecture we will be talking about the layers. We divide this internet into different layers so that we know that what is the purpose or functionality of each layer, so that people can work on different layers. So layered internet protocol stack. In networks, we have different layering sort of thing, OSI model, right? But for internet, we are merging different layers into a one layer, but the functionalities obviously would be same as the network's OSI layers. So we will see why we need layers. So protocol layers and reference models. So we know that networks are complex with many pieces. In terms of hardware, they have hosts, routers, links of various media, right? Applications, protocols, hardware, softwares. So question, is there any hope of organizing structure of network? Like if we want to combine all of these things, then obviously we do require some sort of protocol layers. So every we will divide. So we have one example from air travel sort of thing, how we organize air travel, right? And from that example, you can easily understand. Same is the case with networks or the internet. So example is organization of air travel, end-to-end transfer of person plus his or her baggage, right? So how would you define, discuss the system of airline travel? A series of steps involving many services. Like from the starting or from the source, we have to purchase ticket, right? Then baggage, check-in thing, then we have to load it gates, right? We are using then for takeoff runway require, then airplane routing is determined, right? And similarly at the destination, same sort of layering is required. The persons who are responsible for airplane routing at the destination, persons having similar skills would be managing airplane routing at the destination as well, right? Similarly for runway landing, if we require runway for takeoff, then obviously for landing we require a runway. Then there would be for unloading, we would require gates, and then we have for claiming our baggage, and then if there is some issue with airline or something, we can complain with the same people, just like for the same people we would be purchasing tickets, right? So see, for this sort of air travel we have organized this process into multiple steps or small steps, or we call it layers, and every layer has some different work. Obviously they are interconnected with each other, they are dependent on others, but each layer has different work, right? So each layer implements a service via its own internal layer actions. Obviously the services that this layer baggage is providing and people who are working in the airplane routing sort of thing, they don't have concern about the baggage, right or wrong, usually, obviously, right? The person who would be handling runways, he or she has no concern with ticket price or someone has ticket or no, okay? So every layer has its own service. And each layer is connected with the same layer at the destination end. This is very important. If there is some issue with baggage layer, this layer will communicate with this baggage layer at the destination, right or wrong, right? For example, if they forgot different bags to send, they will tell to the other baggage people that this bag is missing from the flight because it's left here. Okay, so communication, no doubt a person is commuting through these layers by this way, here, and then there, but there is intercommunication between each layers at the both end, at the source and the destination. You can consider this thing as a sending host, this side, and the destination host, which would be collecting your data. It could be some other person who is using Skype. It could be Google or Facebook server, okay? But layers thing are there. So providing services and communicating with each other if they have some issue or if they want to share some information, okay? So why layering approach to designing, discussing complex systems? Obviously, explicit structure allows identification, relationship of systems pieces, and layered reference model for discussion. And this modularization eases maintenance. Now only baggage people have to communicate with other baggage people who are working in the baggage area, okay? And this modularization would definitely ease maintenance and updating of system. If we talk about this internet protocol stack, we have five layers, okay? Application layer, transport layer, network layer, link layer, and physical layer, okay? Physical layer is very simple. All the wires, all the physical media, this belongs to this physical layer. Ethernet, switches, routers, hardware, right? Application is your WhatsApp application, GUI, that you see for WhatsApp or Skype or Zoom. This is your application layer, okay? It will be that application, that GUI is a process in computer system, and this process would be communicating to the application layer, okay? And then from application layer, data would be sent to transport layer, and every layer has different protocols, okay? HTTP is a protocol of application layer. TCP is a protocol of transport layer. And IP is a protocol of network layer, okay? So for internet, mostly we use TCP/IP protocol. So application layer, supporting network applications, HTTP is a protocol, IMAP is there, SMTP protocol, this protocol is used for transferring your emails. So basically Gmail uses SMTP protocol. Similarly, we have domain name system, how to convert your facebook.com to a particular IP address, okay, DNS, domain name, service or system. So these are the different protocols that are running on the application layer. Then we have transport layer, and the main function of this transport layer is process to process data transfer, okay? And we have two very famous protocols, TCP and UDP. If you want reliable communication, you will definitely need TCP protocol, okay? But if you want some sort of fast communication, just like video streaming, okay? Because in video streaming, you don't usually require reliability or some sort of that thing, right? But obviously, if you are live streaming some match and there are so many noise and jitters and blockage, if you are using TCP. But for that thing, you can use UDP, okay? But UDP is not reliable. So if you are making some application, you have to decide that application would be using which protocol at which layer, on which layer, right? At the networks level, we have routing protocols, and this network layer is responsible for routing of datagrams from source to destination. Basically, routers, functionality of routers is more concerned with this network layer, okay? And a very famous protocol is IP protocol, internet protocol. Then we have link, right? So data transfer between neighboring network elements, Ethernet is there, Wi-Fi routers are there. We have different protocols. 802.11 is a name for Wi-Fi protocol, technically. And then in physical, simply wires, bits, right? Bits on the wire. This is for related to physical layer. So services layering and encapsulation. At the application layer, you can see same five layers at the source and same five layers at the destination, okay? And you have to send data from here to there. So application exchanges messages to implement some application services using services of transport layer. So they will communicate with each other about some applications, right? Transport layer protocol transfers M. So this is the actual message, M. This is the actual, you can say that you are sending one image, or one PDF file. This is M, okay? But after this layer, you would be adding some header information, because you are dividing your data into different packets, and how you will stitch that data back to one PDF file or some other routing information, because for each packet you have to mention its destination, and obviously you have to mention its source, right? Can anyone tell when you are using Facebook on NUIG network, how router will know that, NUIG router will know that, okay, your page is coming back from the Facebook, right? How it will know that that page should go to this laptop, not this laptop or this laptop? Just think, take 20 seconds, but do think, how is it possible? You are connecting to the same internet, you are connecting to the same router. But router cannot remember all the requests, right? If thousands of people are using in the internet at one time, then obviously your router cannot remember all the requests that going in and out, right? Even if you put some database in the router, it will delay your response. And obviously we don't want any sort of delay when we are using websites or when we are surfing something, right? So why data coming from my Facebook page will not open on your laptop but on my laptop? Okay, think.
Because the router assigns you an IP address.
Sorry?
Is it because the router assigns you an IP address and you cannot go
to? Yeah. So that header information, would contain source information as well, right? Because this header is generating by a source. So when this destination would be sending some data back, it will tell this data is for this particular source only, not for this laptop or this laptop, okay? And at the end, this Ethernet switch will decide, okay? Router will not decide, because all of these computers are connected with some Ethernet switch, okay? And then this Ethernet switch will decide, okay, this data is for this laptop, okay? So this header information, that's why this transport layer would have some extra header. It would contain some other information that this packet, this message is divided into 20 packets. It means that at the destination, your application would be waiting for 20 packets to come and then combine, and then it will present it to the application layer, okay, to the presentation layer. Then a transport layer protocol encapsulates application layer message M with transport layer header HT to create a transport layer segment. And then this HT used by transport layer protocol to implement its service. Okay, they would have some information. Then we have network layer, and just like HT, we would have another header added. So you can see this is the actual size of our message, but it's keep increasing because of adding layers, right? And this network layer will contain some other information from one host to another using link layer services, and encapsulates, and we can call this as datagrams packets, okay? And similarly for link layer, it will add another packet here, header information. And obviously this header information would be very, very small as compared to the actual message. Otherwise, your one MB file would be 10 MB data, right? It wouldn't be 10 MB. It's just like instead of 1 MB, it would be, after adding all headers, it would be like 1.1 MB or something, okay? Very small informations. Then physical layers will encapsulate this thing, and then it will transfer all this thing, right, and to the destination. and at the destination this layer will cut this header that is related to the link layer header. It will read and decide what it should do, right? Services, because this protocol layer has mentioned services here as well, okay? And then it will pass remaining data to the upper layer, network layer. And then network layer will extract information from this packet, from this HN, right? And then it will pass this thing, and then transport layer will pass the actual message to the application. So if you are sending one image to the WhatsApp application via WhatsApp application to another application, then this image would be M, and then this application or this image would be shown on your phone or something. Okay? Any question about this layering thing? Each layer has some services. For each services, they do add some sort of information in the packet so that the next layer there, they can understand what they have to do, okay? So we can see here, like if we have this packet M message, it will be going through all the layers, and then the first contact, first hardware that would be reading this packet would be a switch, Ethernet switch, this one. And Ethernet switch has only concern with these two layers, link layer and physical layer, okay? They don't have any concern with the network layer or transport layer or even application layer, okay? So it will only, what it will do, it will read header information of physical layer and link layer, and according to the services asked, it will do the same, it will provide the same service that would be mentioned in the headers of link layer and physical layer. And then it will pass again the information or complete packet, and might be it would change the header informations of link, right, to the router, okay? Now for switch and router link, it will add its information here, link and physical. That's why when the destination would be sending something, router will know that, okay, I have to send data to this switch, and then this switch will decide, okay, I have to send data to the particular computer, okay? And from switch, you can see router will be using this network layer thing. On the basis of this, then it will send to some other routers, and all the routers will only need data about network layer, and then at the destination, same is the case with link and this thing, okay? So we call it segment, datagram, frame. These are the different names of every layer, so yeah. So it's just animation, and then at the end, as so, any question? So application layer protocols are often part of the app, libraries running in the untrusted space, and that's why we are using this at the user level. That's why when we are writing on the browser, we do mention HTTP, okay, www dot something, but by default browser knows that when someone is writing www.facebook.com, it means that he or she wants HTTP, right? And then this TCP IP thing, mostly it is done by operating system. And then your network card is using or taking this information, these packets, and sending it to the internet. And then from the internet, again, your network card would capture this sort of data, and then it will pass to the operating system. And operating system would be handling this sort of thing, TCP IP sort of thing. and then operating system would pass data to the app, okay, WhatsApp, yeah, or any other app. So we have different application communication needs. Like if we want web, and web obviously for web we do require TCP. Other as a transport services we require TCP. But for DNS, because DNS information is very short, they only have to exchange very small messages, and they want quick or fast communication. That's why they are using UDP. Okay. And we will discuss TCP and UDP when we would be discussing transport layer, because these are the two protocols related to the transport layer. And for Skype, Skype is also using UDP. For authentication sort of thing, username and password sort of thing, they would be creating a TCP connection, but once connection is established or people are identified and they want to send some they want some communication, then the channel communication would be UDP, okay? So that it could be fast, otherwise it would be slow on TCP. So TCP is slow because it's reliable, okay? And it's more secure, and it guarantees, TCP guarantees that your packet wouldn't be dropped. If it drop, it will resend it. But UDP has no guarantee of reliability. But because it's not managing any number of packets, it has no concern that that particular packet is reached to the destination or no. That's why it's fast. So in OSI session or in networks layers, usually we have seven layers, but in for internet, what we do is that like we usually combine these three layers into one layer, known as application layer. So all the functionalities of presentation and session layers are now managed by application layer. What is a session? Can anyone tell what is a session? If you are logging to Facebook and you are surfing different pages within the Facebook, it means that you are connected to the server with one session. Otherwise, for each request, you have to log in again. That's why they don't ask you to log in again and again if you are surfing in the same amount of time. But remember, like if you are using some AIB or some banking application, if you are idle for 20 seconds or 1 minute, there would be one message pop up that you would be logged out in 20 seconds or something, right? Because they will cancel your session. When you are connecting to the server, so there is some fixed time that session could be unlimited length. That could be for 30 minutes, that could be for 20 minutes, or if there is no request from the client, then this session would be expired in 1 minute. And usually your financial applications have very shortest sessions. Otherwise, it's very easy to someone else to use your session and he or she can do transactions on your behalf, okay? So this is a session. And this session would be controlled by your application layer. Remember application layer, then because it's saying some information, it will add information. Okay, this session is for 30 minutes. This session would be, so this is a service by application layer. And when this packet would reach to the destination, then this destination will know that, okay, I have to keep this session for 15 minutes only because this application is saying this, okay? So this is a session. So there are so many, this is some statistics of from Cisco VNI Global IP Traffic Forecasting that you can see how much data or how many devices or which devices are using M2M are machine-to-machine devices. These are the devices like ATM machines, communication, or machine-to-machine, like if Fitbit is communicating with some other server. So you can see like tablets are just 3%, TVs nowadays 13%, but it's based on the 10% total actual traffic. So it could vary. Like smartphones are using 24% of the internet nowadays. right? Or in every year, we can see share is. Similarly, by industry, connected homes, this one, colors are not very different here, but yeah. So this 20% are for connected homes, and you can see it keep increasing. Similarly, for energy, 24%, and health, this green one is for health services, health industry every year, how much data or how much internet they are using. And what is the purpose or application data in terms of, like, for videos, internet videos, 55% of the internet people are using, okay? So, like if YouTube or some other video streaming sort of thing is banned, we can use same infrastructure for 10, 20 years, there will be no, but yeah. Even in many universities, I don't know, obviously not at NUIG, but there are some universities which have some policy of using YouTube, like from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. you cannot use YouTube on university network, because otherwise, yeah. So there are some restrictions in U.S. universities, but I don't know if they are here or not. Okay, so any question again? So far we have discussed about the internet, and I hope now you can, at least the big picture of the internet would be clear, right? How the things are working, how data can be transferred from this laptop to the laptop which would be in some other remote part of the world, right? But if they have internet connection. And for the communication, we have a lot of links in between these two computers, thousands of devices. It could be switches, it could be routers. Definitely, if we want to communicate outside our network, we definitely need a router, okay? And that ISP would be providing us a router, and that local ISP or regional ISP would be connected to national ISPs through their routers. That's why we are making networks, okay? And national ISPs would be using their routers to connect to the global ISPs. That's why different continents, different countries can communicate with each other. And for, in terms of functionality, we have converted or we have divided internet into different layers so that each layer could have its own service, so that each layer can communicate with the same layer at the destination end. They can share information, okay? So application layer, what is the second layer? Application layer, what is the second layer after the application layer?
Transport
layer. Network layer, link layer, and then we have physical media, okay? And every layer has its own protocols. You can also define your protocol, but you have to register your protocol to some one company, one organization. And if they say that's a very good protocol, then obviously other applications can use that protocol. And believe me, protocols are just very, very simple things. If I say hi in some particular protocol, it means that the destination or the receiver should know that the word hi means do this action, okay? So for different actions, I have simple some keywords, well-defined keywords. So when I am initiating some communication, I will tell my receiver that, okay, this is my protocol. So just imagine he is your friend or she is your friend, that receiver machine, and she or he will open that book. Okay, this protocol means hi, or this protocol means stop. What does it mean? What I have to do with data, right? So application layer overview, conceptual and implementation aspects of application layer protocols, transport layer service models, client server paradigm, and peer to peer paradigm. Who will tell what is a client server architecture? Anything which would be providing you some service is a server for you, okay? And you would be a host, or you would be a client or end user for that particular server. If you are using Gmail, that Gmail server is a server, obviously, and you are a client, okay? And then we have a P2P applications. We will discuss P2P applications in which there is no client, there is no server. You can simply send and share data. Blockchain applications are based on peer-to-peer paradigm, BitTorrent, and there are so many applications you can make. Even Skype uses overlay networks at the end, when you would be communicating with person-to-person communication becomes peer-to-peer. Skype does not have any server to manage your videos, right? They have a server to authenticate you. They have a server to authenticate you and your friends. Then they can help you to make a connection. But once connection is made, then it becomes peer-to-peer application, direct communication, okay? So if we want some application for direct communication, then it would be a peer-to-peer application. But if we need some services, it could be storage services, it could be email or file transfer services, it could be computing services, then we do need a server, okay? Because server would have many capabilities or much computing power than a simple client. Learn about protocols by examining popular application layer protocols and infrastructure. These are the we talked about this HTTP thing, SMTP, IMAP. These are email transferring protocols, IMAP and SMTP. Then DNS and video streaming systems. So in this course, we would have a lecture. We will see how Netflix is working, right? And this, because this is related to video streaming sort of thing. In terms of programming, we have one concept of socket, and very related to socket, we have a one concept of ports. Have you heard this name port? Port number. What is a port number? 8080 or 80 or something. Ever you are installing something, especially on your laptop, not on the mobile, they do ask some port number. Okay. No? Haven't heard this name. Port number. So basically, ports in laptops and in computers are virtual ports. It's not a physical sort of thing. But every process, what is a process? Your WhatsApp application is a one process which is running on your mobile. Okay? And this process would have some one port, just like a mail letterbox. Okay? So that operating system will know that WhatsApp is connected virtually, not a physical thing, because this ports or sockets thing are not a physical thing, they are virtual numbers. Okay? So it will assign some port number, 23, port number 8000. There are around 65,000 ports in every computer. Okay? These are the numbers which can be assigned to particular processes. Okay? So this port number is very important, and this port number would be part of your communication, because when this laptop will receive your Facebook page, how it will know that I should open this in the web browser or in the PowerPoint slides, right? So this computer has to remember this thing, and it will be remembered via port number. Okay, so in the header, application will add its port number 80. It means that when this will be come back, request will be come back, it will be mentioned that this data is for port number 80, and might be this port number 80 would be using by WhatsApp. That's why that image would be open in WhatsApp, not on the browser. Okay? So in computers, you have to tell each and everything. That so this is a concept of socket programming. You can make applications that can communicate through socket programming, but it's very simple. It's just virtual numbers that you have to assign. And obviously you cannot run two applications on the same port at the same time. Okay? Otherwise it would be a conflict. It is not possible to run Skype at port number 8080 and at the same time some other application on the port number 8080. You cannot bound two applications on the same port at the same time. It is okay if you can stop or shut down your Skype application and then run some other application on 8080, that's fine. But it's not possible that two applications can use same port at the same time. Otherwise, it would be confusion for operating system that how they can send data either to the Skype or WhatsApp interface, okay? So these are the ports. So some network apps are there, social networking, web, text messaging, email, multi-user, network games, streaming, stored videos, YouTube, Netflix, right? P2P file sharing, peer-to-peer, or you can use voice over IP, Skype is using this thing, or real-time video conferencing, for example, Zoom, and obviously Google search, internet search thing. So there are so many network apps. Remote login, okay, your favorites. Any question? So how to create a network app? So obviously we have to write some program, right? And write programs that run on different end systems and they can communicate over network. So like writing a network app is very easy in terms of that so many things would be handled by operating system. In the previous layers, we saw that transport layer and your network layer would be handled by operating system. And operating system, all of you know that what is an operating system, right? Your Android operating system, Mac operating system, or Windows operating system, Linux. These are the operating systems which are providing you help, which are providing basically abstraction of your hardware. They are controlling your hardware without having so much done by end user. So this operating system will do that thing. So communicate over network, then for example, web server software communicates with browser software, right? So if this is a web server, for example, or here, then this can communicate with this system on the browser, okay? So if you have to write some network application, you don't have to worry about the routers thing, right? So like most of the things are already done or they are managing by some other people. So for writing or making a new network app, the most like the major thing is you have to create a GUI. Then you have to define which protocol it would be using. Then it's up to operating system, then it's up to the router or switches. They will handle all the things for you, okay? So no need to write software for network core devices. And we discussed this thing that server is always on host, permanent IP address, often in data centers for scaling, right? And clients can contact, communicate with server. Maybe like sometimes they are connected, sometimes they are not. And they may have dynamic IP addresses. For connection, like if I want to create a connection with Facebook, I need a permanent IP address of that Facebook server, but my IP addresses can be changed at any time, right? Because right now I am using NGIG network, then it could be, it would be different when I would go to my home, right? Then it would be different, or if I use my mobile data, that IP address would be different. but the destination or the server address is usually permanent, and we do require to communicate with that server. Okay, we will skip this thing, peer-to-peer architecture, because we have a one lecture on peer-to-peer applications. But in short, peer-to-peer application, there is no client-server thing. We have direct connection with the other machine, and we can send data. And obviously, this is more scalable solution because you don't require centralized server, but there are some other drawbacks of not having a server, right? So we can stop here for today. And if you have any question, you can ask. So